Welcome back, friends. In this video tutorial, we'll be talking about capillary electrophoresis. Now, this is completely different type of electrophoresis compared with the gel type of electrophoresis, because in gel electrophoresis, we know that gel creates a kind of polymer network. So let me take a color here. Gel creates a polymer network. A polymer mesh like network which contains pores, and the material like DNA or protein, they migrate through these pores, right? And as the pore size is different in different regions, this pore size is the determinant for the movement, and also the movement is determined by the charge or the electric field that is applied, right? But in case of capillary electrophoresis, we separate different chemical molecules. It could be biochemical molecules or other chemical molecules. So those chemical molecules will be separated based on their charge to mass ratio. I mean, charge and their mass, both things are kind of a factor in this case we'll be seeing. So charge to mass ratio. Separation based on charge mass ratio. And this PowerPoint that we're going to see, it is designed by Kevin Olsen. For the chemistry and biochemistry for 2003. So it's completely developed by Kevin Olsen, and this is a huge help for me as well as all of you who are understanding with his PowerPoint here. So I'm not the copyright owner here. So let's talk about this whole process. The process of capillary electrophoresis is very easy. Capillary means very thin tube. It's a very, very thin, though I can't draw very thin. It's the thinnest I can draw. So this is kind of capillary. In capillary, you know that capillary process means it's a very thin tube. If you just dip it into the water or any other solution out there, the solution itself rise up there. So it's kind of structure, like let's say it filled with water, and you somehow put those capillary tube in there. And if you place this capillary tube here, you can see that this whatever solution that is placed here will start to rise in the upper region like that. So that's what is called the capillary action. Now this capillary thing is used in this case. Capillary is very thin tube, and this thin tube in this case that we use is a flexible tube made up with a separate kind of polymer, and we use this tube to transfer all those components that are present there, let's say mixture of components that we have, and we inject those mixture of components somewhere, and those injected component mixture will be separated based on their, again, the electric field. But in this case, the electric field that we apply is huge. Let's say here 1000 volt per centimeter. This is a huge electric field compared with the gel electrophoresis. And a very tiny electric field is enough, but in this case, huge electric voltage is required, and it's required to transfer it because of the interaction that will be present between the wall of the capillary and the sample itself. So we use it to separate things. Let's say here this is anode and cathode. Again, the same things, they're added, but this is the capillary. Let's say the capillary is present by connecting anode and cathode together. Now here the idea is, let's say we have a positively charged chemical factor out there, right? And this positively charged factor, okay, so as you see, this is a anode or positively charged. Let's say the protein that is positively charged out there, so it's a protein, or not a protein, let's say it's a chemical molecule positively charged out there. Now that molecule will migrate from the positive towards the negative charged region, because obviously it will be attracted towards negative charged region, and that it will move through this capillary. And as it is moving through capillary, this positively charged chemical will also have an interaction with the wall of that capillary, because the wall of capillary is produced in such a way, and we are going to see that. So this movement of this molecule through this capillary by two interactions. One is that this molecule has, let's say if I draw it, let's say it's a cross section of that capillary, and that capillary has a particular charged molecule added in the inner surface of that capillary. Let's say that is negatively charged, and the chemical that we want for the movement is positively charged. So the chemical is interacting with the negatively charged inner surface of the capillary, as well as it is migrating towards the negatively charged cathode. That is the idea. And this, in this case of these interactions, two interactions that we see, the movement towards the negative charge as well as attachment towards the negative charge in the inner surface combined together, they form what we call the chemiosmotic force out there, or electroosmotic force, or EOF usually, not chemi, it's in this case electroosmotic force. And this electroosmotic force is very, very important, and that's why the most advantageous part about these capillary electrophoresis, because you know, in case of HPLC or gas chromatography, it's usually the process like a chromatography thing, more used in chemistry purposes than biological purpose. Gas chromatography, HPLC, and all these things can be used. Mass spectrometry can also be attached for all this case. But the problem with HPLC and gas chromatography is that the separation of the liquid phase from the solid phase, separation of the running phase from the stagnant phase. But in this case, there is no point of doing this, because in this case, it can easily be transferred from one place to another place without being this phase separation to do. So that's the important thing here. So this electroosmotic force is a very vital thing, and that is developed due to these two interactions that I've told you. Now here the velocity of the movement, I mean the velocity for that molecule to migrate, depends on the field strength and the electrophoretic mobility. That's what I'm talking about, electrophoretic mobility or electroosmotic force, whatever you say. So here it is the electrophoretic mobility that is denoted with this U. EP, electrophoretic mobility, and that is determined by three different factors. One is the Z, that is the net charge of the analyte, in this case analyte, whatever thing we check, the chemical molecule, the net charge in capital Z, and also the N, that is the viscosity of the medium, that is obviously playing a vital role there, because as we're talking about the capillary thing, definitely it is something to do with the viscosity. And obviously, the Stokes radius. The Stokes radius is a thing, technical term I'm not going to explain, but Stokes radius is related with the mass of that analyte. As the higher the mass, the Stokes radius will be higher for that particular analyte. So as you can see it here, the variables that are governing the electrophoretic mobility here, charge, net charge, that is the capital Z, that's the playing a most vital role. If it is a higher charge, the mobility will be very fast. The radius means the Stokes radius, that means obviously it depends on the molecular mass of that sample or analyte, and the mobility, that is depending upon the viscosity a little bit. So these are the three things. Electroosmotic flow, UOF, we've told you about this. The flow is a phenomena resulting when a solution is contained in a capillary with fixed charge along its wall, that I've told you. Two interaction. One is the interaction with wall of that capillary. Second thing is the directionality depending upon the opposite charge, that is from positive towards negative if the analyte is positive. So let's say this is thing, analyte is positive, it will migrate towards that. If the analyte is negative, it will migrate towards this. So from where does this electroosmotic flow come from? Simply, this is the anode, this is the cathode, capillary is placed, and I forgot to tell how we detect the presence of these analytes at the end. At the end, we have a detector. The detector that is present at the end of the detection scheme here. And the detector can be UV detector, any other means of detector. So here we apply the 1000 volts per centimeter thing here, and the analytes start to migrate. As the analyte is positively charged, try to migrate towards this cathode over there. So as you see it here, the ideal thing about electroosmotic force is that this is the cross section of the capillary, and if you see, the capillary is made in such a way, it is filled with this negatively charged molecules in the inner surface region, the inner region of the inner wall of that capillary. And this interior wall of the capillary, as it contains, these are ionized charge, and this is made up with silanol group. And actually the whole capillary is made up with silanol group. Making it with silanol group added advantage is that it makes this capillary more flexible in nature. So, and the silanol group is fused with silica to give it a kind of rigid but flexible structure. It covers all those negatively charged ionized silanol groups on the interior wall. So once it is present there, and once we have those positively charged molecules present there, let's say these are the positively charged analytes that are present, and they are interacting with the negatively charged wall here. That is the first thing of development of electroosmotic flow. Alongside, it will move towards the negative end. So this is the idea I've told you. This is the positive end. This migrates. This positively charged analyte will migrate towards the negative end. Now imagine constructing this hole as a capillary like this. It will migrate like this. Okay, so this is the negative end. Now in this case, pH plays a very vital role, as well as silanol population. It depends, I mean, these are the things, this pH, silanol population determines the electroosmotic flow out there. Because at the very low pH, if you look, not many silanols are ionized, because for the ionization of silanol, it's importance of a pH. So it's a low pH, not many silanols are ionized, in that case the EOF is slow, so the movement will be slower. As the pH start to increase, those silanols will start to ionize more. So the interaction between the positively charged analyte and the silanol will be more, and the EOF will start to speed up steadily. And then finally, when it reaches the highest pH out there, then all of those number of ionized sites are reached in the silanol, and the EOF speed reaches the maximum, right? So that's how we know about it. And if you look at here, the same thing I'm explaining here, the EOF and the movement, the actual movement. If the analytes with the net positive charge will move faster than EOF, right? So if an analyte is having a net positive charge, right, it will move faster. If the analyte with no net charge is present, it's a kind of neutral analyte is present, in that case it will move at the same time with EOF, with the velocity of EOF. And if the analyte has a more negative charge, it will migrate slower compared with the EOF, right? Because if it's a kind of negative charge, it is going towards negative end, it will move very slowly. But if it's having a net positive charge more than, in that case, it will move towards the negative end very, very fast. If it's have a kind of neutral charge, it's kind of moving with the EOF. So EOF will take it as its normal velocity. Now the separation efficiency and the diffusion coefficient, these are the two important things that matters. And one thing that also matters here is the size of the sample or analyte. If it's very small, then in that case, doing capillary electrophoresis is not good enough, right? Because normally for the smaller molecules, what happens, smaller molecules have less diffusion coefficient. I'm not going to talk about details about diffusion coefficient, but smaller molecule have less diffusion coefficient. So as a result, in that case, they will have a separation efficiency less. So if you look at here, the separation efficiency dramatically falls as the diffusion coefficient gets down. So for the very tiny molecules, it will fall very fast, and the separation won't be very easy for those molecules, and you won't get a kind of resolution. You'll get kind of resolution similar to HPLC, high pressure liquid chromatography, not more than that. So it's not a good idea to use that, because we are using capillary electrophoresis to exclude out all the problems that we associate with HPLC or GC. That's why we're using it, because these are better in resolution compared with the HPLC thing. And so what we do and how we do that? So we have a capillary coming in. Let's say we have this capillary thing. We have a detector at the end. This is the detector, and we have a region for injecting that analyte. This is the injection point. So this is start of, say, plus end, minus end. This is the capillary. This is a kind of schematic presentation. So what we know about here is that there are two different methods for injecting our desired analytic mixture. One is the pressure differential, that's applying a pressure across the capillary while it's dipping into the sample solution. That is one thing. Second thing is that electrokinetic injection, by applying voltage and allowing ions to migrate to the capillary. So two things. One is applying a pressure, second is applying a voltage. So either we can apply the pressure there, or we can apply a voltage there. Now, if we want to apply the voltage, definitely the injection site should be slightly upfront from the anode over there, right? Because obviously, if the molecules are placed, molecules should be placed from this area. So voltage should start before that, not after that, okay? And if you're adding the pressure, it can work in any place, but for using pressure to inject all those analyte mixture into the capillary, we definitely need a separate pressure room out there. So usually what we do start to create kind of bubble-like structures at the end, as well as at the front if we are using pressure for this purpose. At the end, where the detector detects the presence of these analytes, we have a kind of bubble-like structure. So it's a kind of artificially designed structure that so that the detector can detect this ultimate region very well, because we no longer require capillary regions at the end where we are detecting things. Now, the last thing is the advantages of capillary electrophoresis is that the number of theoretical plates is typically the hundreds of thousands. There is no mass transfer between the mobile and stationary phase. That's the most important point. What is the disadvantage of HPLC is now the advantage of capillary electrophoresis, because in HPLC or GC, what we need to do, there is a mass transfer between mobile and stationary phase, and that takes some time, as well as some other problems during the separation and then the running of all this process. But that thing is never happening in case of capillary electrophoresis. So in case of capillary electrophoresis, the flow is kind of constant. That is called as a laminar flow, right? And smooth over time. So that's the advantageous part of that. And also, altering column conditions allow focusing or concentration of the sample. These are binary, but the major thing is there is no mass transfer between the mobile and stationary phase, and that's the most important part of all. So these are the advantages of capillary electrophoresis, and that's how we use capillary electrophoresis. So that's it for the video. I hope that's helpful. If you like the video, hit the like button. Please subscribe to get more videos like that, as well as share this video with your friends in different social networks. Thank you.